There are a lot of people suffering in corners that we can't see, in dark places where we can't go, but they're still suffering. These people are having to go to jobs where the ability of others to now say ugly things to them has almost been legitimized. And I get calls and I meet people in airports who tell me about how things are not the same on their jobs. So it's for these people that we do this.
Texas Congressman Al Green, first of all, thank you so much for joining me right after pretty much your speech and the vote on the House floor. You were very emotional today when Steny Hoyer brought your name up. And I saw someone on Twitter say, if Al Green was, and Al told you so, you were not told you so. You basically began the impeachment process before the process that we saw that went to the Senate, and Nancy Pelosi stopped it, Democrats stopped it because they felt it wasn't time. What say you now, sir?
Well, first I say thank you for giving me the opportunity to say some things that probably I should have said on the floor. I was a little bit discombobulated, and I want to first say that I should have thanked Mr. Hoyer more. He did not have to come to the floor with that message. And I think that what he did was allow for the people who were there at the genesis of this to be noted. And there are some people who provide the infrastructure and they are then faded into the back pages of history, if at all. So I thank Mr. Hoyer. It was an awesome thing that he did. Now, with reference to this whole process and being among the first, there were 110
Waters. Maxine Waters was screaming for him to be impeached, and you began the conversation of impeachment. You began it. Why did they? First of all, what was your article of impeachment when you were trying to impeach Donald Trump, and why?
Well, the last one was one that dealt with his being unfit for the office. And there were 95 people to sign on to that one. That was when we reached critical mass. And I think that one provided reasons for persons to pause and say, maybe it's time to give this some consideration. The first one was the first 58 people, and I styled them first 58, the historic 66, and the noble 95. And the first 58, I was very much concerned about the president's behavior and his invidious discrimination. The second one had to do with the president's putting his bigotry into policy. All of these were really about one thing, and that was the way the president weaponizes hate. And he does it very efficiently and effectively. And the zenith of that was on January the 6th, when persons stormed the Capitol of the United States of America. So we believe that this foundation made it possible for us to do some additional things, but I don't want to in any way minimize the two articles of impeachment that one has succeeded and one will succeed today. I credit those persons for moving us forward as well. I'm just pleased that Mr. Hoyer recognized those who were there at the genesis.
You had the vision, you tried for 2 years to impeach this president that many people thought was unhinged. That he was coming up with racial rhetoric. He was impeached, but he was not convicted. He was not removed. Now the effort is to impeach for removal and so that he will not be able to run for office again and so that he will not get the money that goes along with a president after he leaves. What do you feel about the second impeachment? Because I remember when you tried before, you said, oh, we can impeach as many times as we want. And now you are going to try to remove as well as take anything that he can do after presidency away from him. What do you think about this?
Well, thank you. It's ironic that you would bring this up. I have a BuzzFeed article. I'm not going to promote something else on your program, but we talked about this in some detail, and this is sort of coming full circle because we did contend that he could be impeached multiple times. And This is the article from BuzzFeed where we were talking about that. But here's my thought. I think that it doesn't matter how many times, as long as we ultimately get a trial in the Senate and hopefully the president convicted so that he cannot serve again, because there are a lot of people suffering in corners that we can't see, in dark places where we can't go, but they're still suffering. These people are having to go to jobs where the ability of others to now say ugly things to them has almost been legitimized. And I get calls and meet people in airports who tell me about how things are not the same on their jobs. So it's for these people that we do this. It's also for the people who really they're voiceless to a certain extent and they expect someone to stand up for them. So I'm proud to say that there are some people in this Congress who are doing that, and we ought to recognize them. You mentioned Maxine, and I mentioned her, but Maxine Waters does that, and there are others, but she was kind of there, you know, we're running, you know, around trying to get people to understand what was going on, and it wasn't easy for her either. She was threatened, and her life was in jeopardy. So if I'm speaking kind of all over the place today, please forgive me. It's kind of a all over the place day. It's a very sad day. Just a sad day.
They were having discussion on impeachment, then the vote, correct?
Yeah, well, we had a rule. There's a rule associated with a bill. And it defines how you can approach it on the floor, whether it's you can have amendments or not. So that was the rule that we were talking about this morning when Mr. Hoyer spoke. And again, I'm grateful to him. And then after that rule, at some point we'll vote on the actual articles of impeachment. So the debate will start on those. I believe there will be 2 hours of debate divided equally. And that debate will start sometime after we have finished the vote on the rule.
So what was the vote was on the rule?
Yes, the vote is on the rule. And that vote is 215 for it and 201 against it. There are 17 people who haven't voted and they haven't closed the vote yet. So the vote could change, but currently it's 215 for, 201 against, 17 not voting.
What do you think is going to happen in the Senate?
It's difficult to say now because the president was a bully. He's still a bully. And there's something about bullies that I learned when I was in high school. If someone gets a bully down, no one really wants to applaud the bullies getting up or celebrate the bullies getting up or even help the bully to get up. When the bully is down, people have a sigh of relief almost. I think that over in the Senate, they're starting to have a sigh of relief knowing that this may be the end of the president's reign of terror. He has terrorized the Senate. You look at people like Lindsey Graham, how he just beat up on him to the extent that Mr. Graham has bought into everything Mr. Trump wanted to do, except when he got to the insurrection, he had to part company. And you can look at other members of the Senate. So I think Mr. McConnell is starting to realize that the best way for us to deal with this bully, not to hurt him physically, and when I say down, I mean politically. While this bully is down, let's not let him get back up and with the same level of vigor and vitality and strength politically that he had. I think they're considering whether impeachment, such that he cannot run for office again, is going to benefit the Republican Party. And I believe that there's some staunch Republicans who believe in small government and you know, they have some very conservative issues related to social justice and that sort of thing. But they see the opportunity to rid themselves of a bully for life, not to hurt him, but to extricate him and to prevent him from getting back into their political lives. I really do believe that there is some discussion going on about finding him guilty and preventing him from getting back into public life.